Welcome to the first How to Fish North Carolina Waters seminar, sponsored by the new Cypress Landers Fishing Club, which is a subsidiary of our yacht club here at Cypress Landing. As you know, Cypress Landing, where we live, sits on the magnificent Pamlico River, just a few miles from the point where the Tar River, known for its tremendous freshwater fishery, joins the Pamlico River. The Pamlico River is known for its brackish and saltwater fishery. And where those two join, both saltwater and freshwater mix, and it creates one of the most diverse biological areas in the entire country. That's one of the reasons why many of us that love the water, love fishing, and love nature selected this place to live. It's a magnificent river and a magnificent resource. This year, the Yacht Club Bridge under Commodore Tom McCluskey set a goal of increasing active events on the water by reviving some of the older events we've had here at Cypress Landing, as well as some new events for residents to enjoy. The fishing group is a result of that initiative. My name is Bob Douglas. I'm the rear Commodore this year for the Yacht Club, and my job this year has been to encourage those fishing related activities. I'll act as facilitator for tonight's program. I'm pleased to introduce tonight's panelists for you. These are a distinguished group of Cypress Landing residents with a reputation for knowing how to fish, and knowing how to catch fish too, which is even more important. I think you're going to enjoy hearing from them. They're a veritable fountain of knowledge relative to fishing. And oh, by the way, they're great storytellers too. Our first panelist is Wilson Holmes, who is an assistant dock master here at Cypress Landing Marina. He's joined by another one of our assistant dock masters, Driss Zugari. Steve Spanbrook is with us this evening. Eddie Patton, the fellow down on the end with the funny hat. And Larry Crosby and Jeff Howitt. These gentlemen are a great group of fishermen and residents, and I think you're going to absolutely enjoy hearing from them this evening. The format tonight is I'm going to ask several kind of leading questions and ask the panel to respond, just to warm things up, and we'll follow that by a Q&A session, and we'll try to be out of here about 7:45. Rumor has it there's something happening upstairs, and it costs $1 to play tonight. All right, so gentlemen, what do you catch on Chocowinity Bay and on the Pamlico River and its adjoining creeks? And you can start in any order you'd like. Eddie, why don't you fire?
Yeah, I'll start. The amount of species of fish that you catch right here and in the river is amazing. Let's see, I'll go down the list and I'll probably miss some of them, but you have trout, redfish, flounder, largemouth bass, one of them, a crappie, white perch, and it goes on and on. So any kind of we have a real good mix of freshwater and saltwater, and it changes. You know, so the season changes what you catch. We're coming off of winter, which is really rockfish season. You can still catch some rockfish right now. You can catch largemouth bass out there right now. And we're coming up on a time where we'll start to catch red drum, redfish, and wow. So.
Anything that any of the rest of you want to add on that point?
No, I think you nailed it. I mean, that's virtually everything. White perch, yellow perch, largemouth, striped bass or rockfish.
Bowfin.
You can catch strange things like bowfin.
Occasionally a gar.
Broom.
I have called a chain pickerel out here.
Yeah, we've caught a couple of those too.
A couple chain pickerels.
All right, second question, gentlemen. What do you consider when you're deciding where to fish in this area? In other words, how do you find the fish?
Word of mouth.
Yeah, word of mouth.
talk to the other guys that are watching us right now. He fish a lot. Yeah. You know, it could be in Blunt's Creek up all the way to the Sound, literally, depending on the raining days that we had before. the wind.
Yeah.
Yeah, it depends how much fresh water we have in the creek. Right now, we have a lot less fish in our creek than anywhere else. I mean, you just go Blunt's Creek down. It's a little bit saltier. You'll get better luck.
Wind and weather. You know, which way the wind's blowing? Because you have cover and structure out here that will set up nicely if the wind's coming out of the west, or and it'll change if it comes out of the east. So you have to fish everything different.
So that was one of the questions on here. Do you pay attention to wind direction and weather, and what does it tell you?
Yeah.
So why don't you talk a little bit more about that quickly?
Well, the wind direction is going to tell you, hopefully, where the bait are, and where the bait are, where the big fish are going to be. So I always look for, you know, which way the water's flowing. I mean, you think it would be always going east, or west to east, because it's a stream or it's a creek. But because of the winds, if there's a high wind on the outer banks, the water will actually be moving from east to west in here. So depending on which way it's flowing was where I'll set up on a point, whether on the east side or the west side. But the fish are basically looking for structure and water temperature and something to eat. That's really all that they care about. And so if you can kind of figure out that those three items, you can generally find something. It may not be what you're after, but you'll find something.
The one thing that I found that was strange when I came here is there's no tide.
Yeah.
You know, there's, you know, I was always looking at, you know, trying to figure out, you know, what's happening with the tide. I could never figure it out.
Wind tide.
That's about it. So, you know, you really, you know, traditionally, you know, I come from the Great Lakes, you know, and so, you know, we had tide there. And then I fished the Chesapeake, you know, we had tides there. There's just wind tide here. So.
And as long as we're on the subject, fish bite better with moving water. You know, if the water's dead still, you're not going to do as well as if the water's moving.
I know on the coast, I would always fish the incoming and the outgoing tide. Because you got more movement there.
The one thing that I learned here fairly quickly is the wind is probably the most important aspect of where you're going to find fish. Tributaries, anything that feeds the bay is where bait fish are going to be. And they flow with the wind. So if the wind's coming out of the northwest, then you want to fish southeast, and you want to look around those creek mouths, the structure around those things. The other thing you have to be aware of here is we don't have clear water here. We have tainted water here. And so you want to use lures, and I know we're going to get into that a little bit, but you've got to make flash, you've got to make movement that the fish can see, and that's going to be predicated on which lures you use, the colors you choose, etc. But you can't fish this like a clear water lake or a clear water down on the coast like Jeff, you know, was familiar with there. I fish totally different here than what I do in the ocean mainly because of the color of the water.
Okay. So how do you change your fishing methods depending on the time of the year? And start with the spring and go forward through the winter. Do you change it, and how do you change it for the various seasons?
Well, I'll start a little bit.
Who wants to take it?
It's called fishing, okay? Yeah. You try every lure you have in your box, literally. Honestly, you got to try till you get the right one. Depending on the day, on the light that day, how cloudy it is, this changes a lot. You know, sometimes you go with the whites. Sometimes you go with chicken, whatever that thing you call it.
Electric chicken.
You know, it depends on the day.
Yeah.
You know, really, there is no set rules on how you fish. You know, the trial.
Yeah, yeah. But in error. Yeah, he's right. But in the spring, I have a lot of time on my hands, so I'll go up to the local bait shop and get some minnows and some worms and get a bobber and just go old fashioned. And sit on the side of the banks, because generally the white perch, the yellow perch, and the brim are just about hit those any time of the year.
Yeah.
And that winter time seems to be their time of the season around here. Later on in spring, I've caught some really nice yellow perch here, which, you know, we prize up on Lake Erie, and some of them are like 12 and 14 inches. I just never seen them that big before until I came here. But they're here. They're not that hard to catch. They're just like structure. They're on the bottom. So, you know, you can fish with those. And you can catch them right here in the marina.
Yeah, right off the docks. The marina is great cover for a lot of fish. You know, we see them on sonar every time one of our boats goes. You're to see these.
Yeah.
And it'll light it up. But another thing is the species here are large, and I think it's because of the bait, the food that they have. I mean, you know, some of the crappie and the stuff that you and I have drawn out on. Wow, check this out.
Yeah. And right now, the brim are starting to bed. I've seen them today. Yeah. They're right down here on the end of A dock right now. You can go right down there. Water's clear enough or low enough now. You can see the indentions there. They're making their beds. And when you go in there and they're bedding up in their numbers, you can just throw something. They may not be biting, but they're going to protect their nest. And you're going to come at it. You can hook
them. Reaction strike.
Yeah.
And what I found, especially in the colder months, is fish smaller and fish slower. Yeah, because if fish are cold and they can only move so fast. And so I use like these little jerk baits. They're designed, you twitch them a few times and then you pause. And one of my good friends is a professional bass fisherman, and he taught me a long time ago. He said, when you fish a jerk bait, especially in cold water, you got to count to like four really slow when you pause, which is hard for me because I'm an impatient person. But when I do it, typically like March, I was out here fishing in this some of the cover over on the South River for stripers, using this lure right here. And I would count 1,000, 2,000. And usually on the four is when I would get that strike. And they're pretty subtle. But typically the smaller baits will get more bites in the wintertime. The bigger baits in the summertime, fishing faster, much faster. As a matter of fact, you get almost as fast as you can crank it. Sometimes they'll hit it. So you better be ready and have a tight grip on the pole when they do that. But depending on the time of year, too, the species, like you said, white perch, in January, I'll use a little small rattle trap or an inline spinner or a beetle spinner or something and go up into Sibby Creek or Chocowinity Creek or one of these smaller creeks where there's a deep hole. And a lot of times there'll be white perch schooled up in there, and you can catch 10 or 15 of them in a very short period of time and have a blast. But in the summertime, they're a little more scarce. Usually in the heat of the summer, I head east. Because the Chocowinity Bay is pretty shallow, so the water temperature gets up pretty high. Fish don't really like that much. I mean, you can still find them, it's just harder. So going down to Blunt's Bay, even Bellhaven Bath, something like that. Yeah.
And then something, like you said, during the summer months here, it's like we usually go out like early mornings doesn't seem to be all that good. Around about 10 o'clock or so,
you know,
it seems like, you know, the fish are active around that time on the shoreline.
And as you go through the year, like right now, we're entering we're looking for a redfish, and we're hoping some flounder are going to come in, and then that activity is going to pick up, and then midsummer, you know, the big redfish, and when I say big here, 25, 30 inch redfish are going to be in here. And I get them pretty early, you know, pretty early in the morning.
Yeah.
Well, those are the puppy drums, usually follow the crabbing season.
Right.
Yeah, once we start seeing crabs here in the shallows or at the marina, you'll start seeing puppy drums, and they'll usually stay year long, basically. We can fish them through the winter.
And then we'll get a trout run. We hope we're going to get a trout run. We had an amazing trout run, not last year, but year before last. We can tell you some stories. I never will forget. I was sitting at the house, and Larry, I got a call, and it was Larry. He says, 911, man, 911. Get across. Go to your boat. and he was on a creek over here and just catching one right after another. He says, come to me, man. And he sat there and caught his limit. He says, I'm not going to move. There's three guys watching me fish. Bring your boat right in mine, behind mine, and block them out. So I did. So, and I sit right there, and I caught my limit.
Well, But that's really unusual when the trout's running, right?
Yeah.
In Chocowinity Bay, I should say, or even in Blunt's Creek, most of the fish is in the shallows. You really don't fish in the middle of the bay. You're all in 2-2.5 feet. I mean, that's where you want to be, depending on the wind, which side. I mean, you'll be 2 feet and just troll back and forth and just cast. I mean, don't expect to see most of the time the fish in the middle, really, except certain spots that belong to some people.
They're in cover.
I catch them sometimes on the drop where the channel is, usually in the wintertime.
Yeah.
Because usually the only time I troll is when it's so cold, I don't want to stand out from behind the console. That's the time I'm casting, but that's usually when I'll pick them
up. Up here, which is peak. So you can get off the off that point, and you can get out a little ways. There's really a lot of crab pots out there, but you know, you can get maneuver your way through there. And I think my theory is that the fish are attracted to the bait that's in the crab pots, I guess. And so
there's a lot of structure on that point.
And
there's a lot of missing crab pots in there. If you go through there with a sonar on there, there's a bunch of
well, we've got some of the best structure right out here.
Yeah.
We call it the stump pile.
That's right. I mean, if you don't know where to fish, right off that corner out there, there's
he has the coordinates.
It's real easy to find. We can almost point you to it, but great place. I troll through that 3 or 4 times, pick up a rock.
And if you get hung, you're in the right place.
You see the big trees right across the river there. This is my side. There's a big gap in the trees over there. You can kind of see it. It's kind of like just a big empty space. You're out there, you look across there, and you're in that spot lined up with those buoys over there, those danger buoys. You're somewhere in the neighborhood of those stumps out there.
You'll see it on your sonar.
Trees.
Doug will send you the coordinates for that point. It'll be in the email.
It's no real secret. So.
But when the fish are in here, you can fish from the dock. I caught 40 speckled trout one day right by myself. And just, of course, I turned them all loose. But my wife doesn't eat fish, and I just didn't want to mess with them.
What are you using? What other limit?
Glad you asked.
Show and tell time.
People use different things. My favorite in shallow water, and I got this a little bit deep now, but this is a popping cork. It's hollowed out here, and what you do, you cast it out, and when you jerk it, it goes boom, just kind of bloop, bloop, bloop. And every time you do, this thing is pretty much doing that. And I prefer using what they call weedless. Put it like that, and sometimes it helps you. Sometimes helps you to stay away from the stumps and pick up a lot of weed. It's a regular jig head, but it has a wire that just kind of makes it doesn't catch.
Roll through the weed.
Yeah,
and pay a little extra, get something like those Z-Men. They make cheaper versions, but.
This is not a Z-man. Pay
the
buck and a half
and get a Z-man jig.
That far. Because pinfish, if you use, it's good bait. But everybody knows it. All the pinfish love it too. And they will take the tail right off of it. So just find a good, that's a jerk bait right there. It just has a little detail.
I use these popping corks a lot when I have guests that don't fish much because they're easy. The trick is, it's not a float. This is a noisemaker. And so you throw the thing out there, you jerk it a couple of times, and it's supposed to sound like a shrimp clicking. I don't know if that's true or not, but I know it works. And so it works like a float because when it goes under, you got a bite. And it's really hard for me because I grew up, setting hooks like this my whole life. But if you do that when you're fishing these, you tend to pull it out of their mouth. And one of the guides taught me, he said, keep your rod tip down and just reel it tight. And if I can remember to do that, I generally will hook the fish. But, you know, especially people who don't fish a lot, that's a good way to do it. The only challenge is casting. It's a little bit of a challenge, but
it's a visual thing, too. I like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, the plastic that Jeff showed had a split tail on it. This is called a paddle tail.
Yeah.
More action. Paddle tails, more action, makes more noise. When I'm fishing here, I prefer these. When I'm fishing further east, I prefer the split tail because they're different. But as this thing goes through the water, it flaps and makes noise, and the noise will be attractive to the fish.
We got the curly tails, too.
And you got curly tails.
I like even more action. Right here. You get a lot of action on these things. You know, they'll go through the water, and it'll kind of, you know, you got a popping cork on there, too, so it's making the noise, and it's got the action going in there. Well, it's not quite, I'm not doing that, but, you know, it's kind of jigging. But anyway, you know, you get the idea. It'll attract the fish to get it. And then also, the other thing you can do, you know, I'm a live bait guy. Well, a fresh bait. I put a live shrimp. I mean, a shrimp on there. Of course, he's not live. I haven't found any live shrimp around here. But just take a shrimp, put it on the jig head with the popping cork.
Pull that off. Put the shrimp on.
Just real slow, and the redfish will tear it up.
What these things are designed to do is to mimic feeding fish on the surface of the water. And that attracts other fish. They're basically predators, okay? They don't care about each other, and if somebody's into some fish, they want to get into the fish. Well, when you jerk this thing, the bait goes up, and then it slowly flips back down. If you have a paddle tail, or a little bit of action, if you have a shrimp like he's talking about, they're coming. They don't know what they're coming for because they hear it, but then they pick up the bait, and that's when you're able to set the hook and get it.
Tell them about the leaders, though, the weight of the leader. Size of the jig here.
Well, so, you know, this is what, water, it's about an 8 ounce.
Yeah, it's an 8 ounce. I prefer the smaller jig heads up here.
I'm the same way.
Because the fall's a little bit slower.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I use the paddles. But I also occasionally, during the heat of the summer when there's so much grass out there, I switch over to the, like yours, whatever they're called.
The gear here, you can be lightweight. Jeff's got a, that's a 2500, 250 size reel on it.
Yeah.
Okay. Fishing with 10 pound test braid, even if you get a 25 pound fish, you're going to land that fish.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, that's somebody else.
All right.
That's mine. Same thing.
I'm sorry.
It's a paddle. That's a paddle tail Z Man. It's a 15 pound braid.
Yeah.
I'm using about a 6 foot of fluorocarbon leader.
And you got a trout eye on here.
Yeah, got a trout eye on there.
Trout eye jig.
So you don't need anything bigger than that. For any fish from here to the end of the Pamlico.
Yeah.
2,500 to 3,000 series reels are all you need.
You can land a 40-pound fish on that. I got a 40-pound mudcat on that.
The one thing I would say, make sure you buy saltwater reels.
Yeah,
I made that mistake when I moved here. We bought some gear and it didn't last very long. Even though it's predominantly fresh right now, by August it'll be salt.
And you don't have to spend $300 for a reel. $100 reel will do it. And I like to keep 4 reels on my boat. I'm probably going to replace them every two or 3 years because they will salt up. But it's better than having to carry them back to the house every little bit.
I always soak mine down, and then take warm water and rinse it off, and then spray it with a lubricant. Everything going,
but
especially
like,
in the salt
just
atmosphere.
Like, yeah, just like Eddie said, when I fish here, I fish with 4 rods. It's no different than you golfers with 9 or 12 or having irons and wood jam and bag. We have different ones because they're going to have different baits on. And you go through one area and the fish don't bite, you go through that same area again with a different lure on it, you could get a hit. After I wear 4 out, I move.
So
what is the limit?
Well, it changes season to season.
You gotta have to be aware of that. Go online and get the latest thing. It changes. It may be closed for what,
North Carolina's website has a very good app called Fish Rules. And Fish Rules shows you wherever you are, whether you're here or on the coast, and will show you the rules for that particular fish. But around here, the trout were 15-inch.
15 and 4 per day per person.
For trout?
Four. Well, it was four last year.
Last year. No,
I don't know what it is today.
Oh, it used to be eight, but that's okay.
Yeah.
Stripers, you can't. I have to release them. There is a moratorium right now, so rockfish and stripers.
And flounder.
Flounders the same way, although flounder season's going to open up at the end of August and run to about mid-September. Stripers are not open up. We're under government control, nothing we can do about it. As far as the other fish you catch around here, as many as you can keep. There's no limit on perch. There's no limit on... Now, the red drum, you'll hear it called red drum or puppy drum. Puppy drum's got a slot. It's 18 to 27 inches you can keep. If it's less than that, you let it go. If it's more than that, you got to let it go. So,
and you have one over 26.
One a day.
Only place on the planet.
Let me ask one additional question, and that is, Larry touched on live bait and not just artificials. How many of you use live bait, and what do you use?
Well, go first.
Crab, cut bait, cut menhaden, or cut mullet that you can get, go over to the... Is it EW's bait shop or whatever?
Well,
Eastside Tackle.
That's all considered cut baits.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
That's all considered cut baits.
Those are all good. Crab. You can also use live minnows, live line minnows, and work with it. I've fished here now 5 years. First year I came here, I was bass fishing most of the time, and I fished like I was bass fishing here. A lot of artificials. Last year or so, I've learned that I catch as many or more fish on cut bait or live bait, if you want to call it, than I do with artificials. Yes, you can cover more territory from the right spot. Seems like, for me anyway, I'm seeing more success with cut bait or live bait.
Yeah, I think I agree with that. It's live bait. You can catch more fish on it. I'm just lazy.
Well, when we're talking like, cut bait, you can use crabs as well. We do get seasonal crabs here. So you just come into the dock, catch a few crabs. It does not have to be a peeler, basically. Just a hard shell, remove it, cut it in cores, and fish with it.
Young lady in the back.
Period. How are you rigging your live bait? Are you using a Carolina rig or the popping cork?
No, you don't use popping cork. I'm not going to speak for them. Some of them do. I would live line it or a Carolina rig, one of the two. If you're going to do a Carolina rig with a fish, you want a long line. You don't want short line like your bass fishing.
Okay,
you want a long line so that the fish can meander out there. And then what's the thing where the two, I can't remember the name of it, where the two leads come together? Knocker rig is another one that you can use. It's knocker, K-N-O-C-K-E-R.
Guys, let me stop us here and tell you that we're going to shift, because it's already starting to happen naturally. We're going to shift from these stock questions that we started with to open Q&A. Tom McCluskey has a mic over here, and if you want to ask a question on the panel, raise your hand, Tom, and please use the mic, because that way we pick it up in our recording. So raise your hand, and we'll start with an open season Q&A up here in the front, Tom.
I just want to ask Larry, are you using shrimp with the heads on or just the tails of shrimp?
I generally use the one just the tail. Just the tail.
Okay.
Now, if I've located the white perch, like, around some stumps or something, I'll just cut them off and I'll use a tail end. Cut the tail off and just use a regular hook and just throw it out there with a popping cork or a bobber.
Okay.
And I get them, but for the redfish, I'm putting a whole shrimp on there without the head.
Okay.
And I'm just throwing it and I'm just twitching and bringing it back.
See, the lead head jig itself will be a silhouette of a head of the shrimp. So if you have the shrimp on and you float it right up, he doesn't know.
Yeah, you'll get.
But you're using a bobber or that popping cork.
I'm using that popping cork most of the time because what's happened, using that popping cork, I've been trying to catch redfish and get striped bass, they'll hit it as well. As a matter of fact, I've even had a mirror lure on popping cork. I just try stuff and tear them up, you don't expect that.
You'll stick with it.
Yeah, so it worked, So you just try things,
for the trout are using mirror lures or using jigs?
I have a pink one, a pink mirror lure, whatever that number
is. Electric chick.
Yes, that's what I use.
Years ago or something
But they got, they have one now, what is it, this Paul Brown?
Paul Brown is a soft version.
It's a soft version. Now, they love that because, you know, that hard one, they'll grab that sometime and let it go. But that Paul Brown is soft.
Got a mirror lure on.
I got a dark one. I didn't even pull a Paul Brown up. I got
right there with a big eye.
Oh, it goes good.
Yeah. It's soft.
There you go.
It's like a mirror lure. Mirror lures look like this. They have that little iridescent side on them.
Mm-hmm.
So it looks like
same
a fish.
Same size.
Yeah.
Yeah, same size. It's just to what Larry
don't want
saying.
Anything bigger or smaller.
It's just
and
soft.
This is the hard one. This they advertise as dark when they said use it in dark water. Rather, you know, when it said dark water, they said, you know, supposedly, you know, it sets up a silhouette in dark water. And I caught them on that. I'm not going to contest it. That's what happened, but that's what I've done.
It's good to do in Halloween.
Yeah. So that one works, too.
Other questions? Over here. Tanner, if you can get Tom.
We were talking about...
I can just point at it.
I'm really, really new to the area. Come up out of Florida.
Oh, it's totally different here. Whatever you learn in Florida, leave it back.
Anyway, we talked about what and how. How about where? Can you point maybe using the charters to where are some spots that...
what we have there, yeah, we can do that.
Something like me might just stumble onto?
Yeah.
Sure. Well, I can... If you're familiar with Chocowinity here?
Yeah. Yes, but...
Most fishing is by the grass or down the creek or the trestle, literally.
Okay.
I mean... This is Chocowinity.
You got a point for me.
Yeah.
Right straight across. Right straight across.
The 15th hole is a good
place. That'll be one-on-one thing. I'll take you through that.
I had a guy today say, oh, well, you know, I went with a fishing guide, and he didn't show me any secret holes. And I thought to myself, there's no such thing as a secret hole.
Yeah, the fish don't have address.
It's which way the wind is blowing. What kind of time of the year, what the kind of fish are coming in here, and where they're going to set up. And you can catch a lot of fish up on the point of Witcher's Beach right out here. That point right there, over the year, that's probably most productive at different times.
And typically in the warmer weather.
That's right, warmer weather. Now you're not going to catch anything.
Now you go out there.
The 15th hole, everybody knows that plays golf, knows where the 15th hole is. So you can catch massive red drum out there, rockfish. I mean, that's...
I'll have my line.
Okay, yes, Andy, you cannot golf and fish the same time.
Right straight across from the marina, right off that point right there. You see that eagle's nest right over there that sits out on that point. Another great spot where flounder and redfish set up. But it's weather and... Wind and temperature dependent, and that all changes as the year goes through.
And all these spots have three things in common, right? Structure, current,
that's right,
and change in depth.
That's right.
Now, how about the entire river heading towards Greenville? The water all the way there, isn't it?
Fast fishing.
Big stripers are in
during
Tar
the spawning
River.
Time where they need deeper water. The Tar River is the deepest part in the whole Pamlico River.
Just when you're heading that way, follow the markers because you will run aground.
Lost floating logs too.
And look out for floating logs too because there's here too. It's great fishing up there.
You have to remember that every time it rains in Raleigh, it comes here a day or so later. And I mean, stuff can come down that river, as we know, with the estuarium vehicle doing a lot. Big
It depends on the day where the fish is running and depends what you're fishing for. You know, puppy drum stripers, trouts, still in the shallows, by the trestles. If you're fishing at night, you can fish off the bridge if you want. There's a lot of stripers there. It just depends on the day.
But if you want to catch big stripers, go around the corner, go over the Tar River. Right there in right across the docks, from Washington Docks, right over in there, in that deep water, you'll see the water go from about 7 feet to about 14 feet. And them stripers will lay right on that shelf. And
you throw something like this without the float on it up on that ledge, and as it falls down the edge,
bring it down.
Usually when they're falling, they'll get down.
Another thing to think about, never pull a bait into current. Always go with the current. Because what's happening is a striper, a flounder, a trout, or whatever, they're all ambush fish. So they're looking for a free meal with as little exercise as they can. Right. So they're sitting down there and they're waiting, and your bait will just kind of filter down with the current. If he sees a bait going the wrong way, he's like, what the hell's wrong with that fish?
Other questions in the back here?
Night fishing with your boat. Are there a lot of lights out on the water, docks that holding fish, bait fish?
Not in the Pamlico River. It's really dark. Definitely need the lights.
So you don't have docks out here with lights on?
No, our marina is all lit.
Right.
Yeah.
But
most of the private,
a lot of private don't
turn
the lights.
River and don't really have lights on.
Yeah, we need spotlights. I mean, I do a lot of cruising at night for dinner coming from Washington, and it's really, really, really dark. Most of my boating was in Chesapeake Bay. Compared to here, it's nothing. It's really different until you come around here. And there is a lot of floating stuff, and we have a lot of markers here for what we call them, stumps or whatever, that you might not be able to see at night.
Okay, so you're suggesting as somebody's coming up to this area from Florida, night fishing is not...
I wouldn't say no. You could fish at night if you want, but really, you got to get familiar first.
Scout it
during the day.
Yeah.
The only time that I typically fish at night is in the late summertime when we're fishing for big redfish, and that's further down, like Jones Bay, something like that, where you're out with a fish finder and a hunk of meat and hoping something will swim by and pick it up. But I'm usually back here. I usually fish until dark, and then head back home. We haven't talked about topwater at all, but topwater is a great way to catch, especially stripers, rockfish here year round. But in the summertime, in particular, they really will tear it up. Like this time of day, when the sun's getting a little bit low, the one thing is, and today's the perfect day. We probably should all get up and go out and throw a topwater bait because there's that little bit of chop on the water right now, so there's just enough to disguise the bait, and if you find them, you'll have a ton of fun.
What are your favorite topwater baits, guys?
I use X-Wraps a lot. I also use mirror lures, the topwater versions of those. What's that? That's a little popper on the front of it. I can't even think of it right now. Storm bait. Yeah, I use those.
Popper.
Anything that makes a little bit of noise. The one thing we haven't talked about, too, is color. Color, the one thing that I've consistently found is they like a little bit of orange. And I brought in like four of my favorite baits here, and you're welcome to come up and look at them. But all of them have one thing in common, which is a little bit of orange. And the reason I brought this particular float, if you look at it closely, see where all the trout have been tearing up the float, hitting the orange. So I don't know what it is about orange. I've tried all kinds of other baits without orange, and I've had very limited success. You'd think I went to Clemson or something, but
Do you flip off pieces of your shirt if you forget?
If necessary. Whatever it takes.
All for the sake.
Other questions?
How are you catching these flounder? Are you just letting the bait come across the bottom, like you said, let them ambush it?
Jigs.
Smack it.
That's
either the split tail or the pound tail will come in as a soft bait. You just pull it across. Again, you want to be on a ledge. If you're on a ledge where it drops off, the large flounder will be sitting there waiting for the stuff to come off the cliff. You'll catch a bunch of little ones in the shallow water.
And you want to find an area that has a couple foot of depth where the bait fish can't go anywhere. You don't want a gradual decline up to the bank. So if you, like say, if you go right straight across, you'll hit a section of the bank that's, 75, 100 yards down through there, and then it turns to a bad area.
Yeah.
So you know, your fishing will just stop. And the flounder, they like to sit up in there and wait for that bait to come through, and there's no place to go. You know, they're in a couple foot of water. Flounder can look up and, you know, go on and get that.
And another thing about the flounder too, you might not, you know, I've just found out, for instance, up here we got out here like some little bays along the river up here. You go up there, you'll see the little bays. You can go in there and fish those fish lines. I'll always throw a line over, put a piece of cut bait or something on it. And invariably I always get a big flounder. I mean, it's just sitting. I'm not throwing it at the shoreline. I just got it, throw it on the back of the boat sitting in the rod holder. And it won't, generally it won't be long and that thing is pounding. You got a big flounder on it. So those little bay areas are good for that.
You can catch big flounder right here in the marina.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
The biggest, best fishing trip I ever had for flounder was right here on this dock.
Yeah.
Me too.
And after spending hundreds of dollars in gas going to Indian Island, chasing them back.
A number of times.
This past summer, I was working, and Jeff was going out, and I said, if you catch something, bring it to me. Okay, don't release it, because it was flounder. He said, tell him.
I promise I will. Thinking I wasn't going to catch anything.
Yeah. His last cast of the day, 16-inch flounder, and it made a great dinner out there.
Well, that was when
it was legal. We could keep them.
Well, our friend Bill Proctor caught the 21 or 22-inch right in front of the dock, right before the docks.
Yeah.
But the flounder tend to be in the sandy bottoms around here, a lot of times.
Is there a size or limit to the flounder?
I believe it's 14 and a half when it's legal. And then it's only going to be 4 a day per person.
And that changes. Please check daily.
Yeah, you have to check
the latest thing.
Check the laws.
Get Fish Rules app and you'll never go astray.
How are you rigging the cut bait for the flounder? Carolina rig or?
No, I don't use cut bait for flounder. I mean, I use the...
I use the paddle
tails.
Paddle tail.
I'm just jigging. I'm putting it on a bobber with just, you know, probably a number 4 by hook, and with a shrimp. That's what I'm doing. When I'm just, you know, when I'm casting, and I just have one sitting on the back of my boat. But generally, if I, you know, most guys are throwing the gulps or the
gulps.
And
then
you just reel in, you don't set the
jig.
Yep.
For us, just jig in until we get it.
Let's move it slow.
Well, when you feel with a flounder, if there's an old guy who's 2-3 years now, he's been dead, but he was the king of flounder fishing here in North Carolina. He used to have a phrase, if you feel even a little tug, he'd say, break his jaw at that point, pull. Flounder will hit sometimes, but most of the time they suck it in, and they sit there with it in the mouth, and that's why when you pull the line, you feel a little bit of tension. He would say, break the jaw, and that's when he easily set the hook.
And I've always heard that they turn it around.
They'll sit there and do all kinds of stuff.
Kind of turn it around. So you got to give them time. Yeah. You got to let them take it.
Otherwise, you'll cut the tail.
I give a slow, steady.
Everybody have their own style.
Yeah.
Use what works for you that day.
The main thing is when you're feeling, you got to give him just a second. You know, you don't want to. Give him a little bit and then come up on.
What about when you're catching trout, the hooking process? Talk about trout for a second.
They're tough.
You don't want to jerk down on a trout that's got a soft
weak
mouth. Yeah, he's got a soft mouth and a kind of a slow. I like to just slowly increase my tension because a trout will, you know, it'll feel like a little fish pecking, you know, and I just slowly reel. Like I increase that. Speed and
it's a speed.
Yeah. But when the trout are biting, you're typically in a bunch of them. You know, you're gonna catch 30 trout. If you're in the trout, you're gonna catch all kinds of shapes and sizes. It'll start to bump on you and then just slowly pick up the pressure. But you don't want to do this because you'll jerk it right out of his mouth. Trout has very soft mouth.
Other questions?
don't have a boat, where do you fish other than off the
dock?
On the pier?
Golf course.
She said other than the dock.
Other than the dock?
Yeah.
Washington Pier.
The bridges, the trestle here at the end of Chocowinity, you can catch fish there. Blunt's Creek, it is a place you can, it is fishing dock, whatever you want to call it. You can fish off.
Really, if you don't have a boat, the best place to fish is over here in some of our ponds.
Guaranteed fish.
I was not joking when I said
ponds.
But the guys, that new park that they built down there in Washington, what's that?
Washington Park. Well, there is a little fishing pier across from Backwater Jack. You could fish there all day, all night if you want as well. But I see people fishing off across the bridge, you know, every night, night fishing. But the trestle here at the end, Chocowinity, there's a lot of people fish off. I don't know how you get there by car.
You walk down the river.
I've never been there. by land.
Take a friend.
What about kayak fishing?
There's a lot of places kayak fishing across the water here. That's go to the grass and just
If you're driving into Washington on 17, before you get to the bridge, you'll always see a couple cars parked right there. Those guys catch a lot of fish right there.
Yeah.
And they're there almost every day. And that there's a lot of structure right there. We go over there and fish from boat a lot, and see them sitting in there. And they're catching some nice fish, catfish, rockfish, you know.
You catch some good, you know, if you want a night fish, I do this occasionally sometimes. I'll go down here and sit on the dock, in the corner here on A, I mean E, I'm sorry, and just throw some worms with a bobber on it, and you catch some huge catfish. Just catching, you know, some really big ones, you know, get your line broke or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
Some of the high school kids that live here in Cypress Landing have perfected bass fishing in the ponds on the golf course.
Yeah.
And if you watch some of those kids in the evenings, the last two nights behind my house, I've seen a couple of probably 3-pound bass yanked out of there and put back in the water after a lot of pictures.
Somebody's put a striper in there too.
Yeah.
Larry.
One day I was back in the creek back here, and the stripers, they had size on them, but I don't even know if they were seasoned in, but anyway, I was crappie fishing and I started catching these stripers. One right after another. Every cast, and I'm like, man, this is something. I can't keep them. I'm like, well, I can be a conservationist. So I put about 8 of them in my live well, and I brought them back, got back here, put them in a bucket, and took them over and put them behind his house.
So far, they haven't caught any of his stripers, but
they did.
A kid caught a big one the other day.
All right, another question.
Yeah,
it's
like 6 pounds.
My wife and I came over here from Florida to take care of her father, and we didn't think he was going to be around that long, but it's been 9 months now. And we have a ministry in Florida that we brought up here called Wishing and Fishing. We took kids with cancer, foster kids, veterans, single moms, kids that are underprivileged. So anybody who doesn't have a boat, we've got a 24-foot pontoon and a 26-foot tri-tune that we will take you absolutely free.
Oh, very cool.
Thank you.
My wife's got cards and information on how to get in touch with us. We try to bless people. And if you know anybody in the categories of kids with cancer, anybody with cancer, veterans, anybody that needs to get on the water and breathe, please contact us as well. We do. We've been there for 13 years. So that's awesome.
Thank you, sir.
Fishing.org.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So we'd be happy to take that.
One other thing, guys. The Yacht Club Fishing Group has talked about doing a couple of days this year, probably morning or afternoon fishing trips with those of us that have fishing boats, taking out Cypress Landing neighbors that don't have boats to get out on the water and do a little fishing. You just have to have your license and your own gear. We haven't scheduled those yet, but we are planning to do that, and we're compiling a list of people's names who are interested in both taking people out and people going. So watch for that, and that should be happening this summer, spring and summer sometime.
And remind them about the survey.
Yeah, that's part of the survey.
Right.
Compile it from the survey, yeah. Any other questions?
You had mentioned trolling a while ago. I've spent 20 years on the Chesapeake Drift, probably trolled thousands of miles. How do you troll here?
Carefully.
Yes. Very shallow here.
Lots of stumps out here. It's very difficult.
With something like this, shallow meadow.
No more than 4 feet, 4 or 5 feet at the most.
They're very
and slow.
They get out to Blunt's Creek, and at Blunt's Bay, you can troll out there. But this bay here, no.
You weren't setting up to troll, or forget it.
Chris and I tried it my bass boat.
I do it all the time.
I troll slowly, really, with my dinghy most of the time. I mean, with the float, basically, to keep my bait off the ground. When I troll only in 3 feet, 2.5 feet, I get snagged most of the time. It's easy to do with small boat.
You can catch fish trolling out here, but usually in the wintertime when they're in the deeper water in the channel and using a smaller bait, very shallow bait. Yeah, and I usually put out a spread of, I don't know, 4 rods.
Yeah.
And for some reason, they always hit the same rod. I don't know why.
You can look at your baits and it'll tell you, some of your baits, not all of them, and it'll say depth on here.
Yeah.
And the whole Chocowinity, deepest part is 6.5 feet. If you're lucky, you get 7.
Yeah.
So do the math.
And the other thing is about the creeks. We didn't mention. Those creeks got 15, 18-foot holes in them.
Yeah.
This creeps up back right up here. Sydney Creek, and I don't know.
The fishing group could shoot an email to people saying, now's the time you're catching this and going here. You know what I mean? Like, come on, fish it here somewhere. They say,
I don't know. Do not fish after rain. Do not fish in.
That's a steady day.
She wants a fishing report.
We can tell them.
No.
I don't see why they come in.
We can tell them, when trout
come in.
I'll
call
you. Part of the reason why we're putting the fishing group together is so that we identify who the people are that are interested in fishing, so they get to know each other. And those of you who've done much fishing in your life know that, as Eddie said, as we open, how do you find the fish? Word of mouth. So you know the guy. You get to know the guys, and you talk to them often. That's how you find out.
And if you come up here during the day, if I'm here, Doris is here, but not much longer. We're the two, the fish. We can tell you what we're hearing. These guys can't come in and say, "Oh, I caught a fish this big."
Yeah.
You know, they're going to say it. So we'll know. We have a pretty good idea of what's running.
Check with the dock master, yes.
And like my old buddy Wainwright Land says, fishing's a lot of work. You got to put effort into it. There's no magic pill. We're not going to be able to send out an email and you run down here and catch a fish.
I just meant changing seasons.
I would just ask
people from
the
Florida or other places. We don't know what you're fishing for when.
Yeah,
right.
So,
Yeah.
Probably call to the dock master will help. Tell him, hey, what do you hear? What's running around?
And we're here all the time. Come down. You see us on a boat. Come down. We'll tell you what we're fishing for, what we're trying to fish for, right? And the reason we've got this little circle because we know everyone up here that fishes and call each other on the phone. Did you catch anything? And that sort of thing. And we share that information all the time.
And these guys all have fish pictures on their phones. If you ask, they'll show you what they've been catching and approximately where they were.
Yeah.
Especially those caught down on a pier down.
Like I say, my number one bellwether is if you can't catch a fish standing on the end of this dock right here, you're probably not going to be able to get any fish out here in the bay, because that's a great indication. It's real good cover right out here on the end of the dock, and And Jeff will probably be down there, and Larry will be down there, and you'll get a bite. And if there's nothing biting, if you spend 10 minutes down there casting a Z-Man with a paddle tail, and you don't even feel the bump, you probably should go golf.
Do you put steady kind of scent on your Z-Man?
Yes.
I do. Okay. Shrimp scent?
After that scent.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, and
well, for the lot of new residents, I mean, don't limit yourself to Chocowinity Bay. If you have a trailable boat, there are so many places around here within half hour to 45 minutes to launch your boat. Campbell Creek. The whole intercoastal Blunt Creek, just limitless, you know, so many places where you can fish here. So really,
there are a lot of places. The Pamlico River, really. Those who see me go fishing will see me leave here with two boats. I'll take the big troller, pull the fishing boat, with Midnight Rambler, and I'll go away for 3 days, go down to Swan Court and just camp out and catch, whatever's biting. So there is, if you make it down to the sound, usually that's where you're going to get your be fishing. Yeah. So.
And if you have a boat trailer, a good boat trailer, most of these guys will tell you, rather than drive your boat all the way down there and waste the gas, throw your boat on the trailer, if it's trailerable, and take it to one of those landings down the river, put it in and spend the day fishing.
A real good spot that's not too far from here is a place called Hobucket,
H-O-B-U-K-E-N. Campbell Creek.
You get there 20 minutes to 40 minutes drive, and you're there. Hobucket a little further. Depends on how fast you
try that.
That one might be driving you. That one might be boat.
The closest boat ramp is on Wichards.
Right.
If you just want to put your boat up.
Which I didn't know that until about 3 months ago.
Yeah.
And get your license.
There's a boat ramp on Wichards?
Yeah. It's a private.
No.
$5.
$5. There's an honor box there.
The only thing is gated. It's gated, isn't it?
Honor system. No. It's not gated.
Where's it at on Wichards?
We'll show it to you on the map.
Almost to the end.
Oh, really?
On the left-hand side. There's a little wood honor box there.
Past the Conics, you'll find it on the left.
It's Billy Wichard. He owns it.
It's not a huge ramp, but it's not
good
steep
depth.
And it's
so work boat, work in there. Crab boats that go there from this area.
Other questions? Well, we've been going for about an hour, and so
assuming everybody have the license.
Let me do a little recap. You've heard where to fish, how to fish, what to fish for, where not to go, and what not to do tonight, and these guys are all very good fishermen, and they have the pictures to show it and the stories. Use these guys as resources, as they've mentioned. By the way, after this is over, take them upstairs and buy them a beer. It's cheap to do that tonight, $1 beer night.
And the stories will get better.
Look up.
The fish definitely gets bigger.
Look up these guys and socially.
Holy crap!
Because last time I checked, Cypress Landing is known for having, once we reopen again, a few social events. So you're going to run into all of these guys and pick their brains.
One last thing. They've mentioned it here, but we can't overstate it enough. You have to have a license to fish in North Carolina.
Yeah.
Okay?
That's one thing.
And there's two or three types of licenses. If you're not going to go west, just get an eastern license and fish. That covers you from here down to the salt water. Now, if you're going to go up the Tar River, there's a different license you got
to
get.
If you come from Chocowinity and Pamlico, two different licenses.
So just tell them you want a salt water license.
Get the two.
The inland water sign. The
combination.
The
combo.
So you need
the combo. $34.
And a coastal license. Yeah.
And they will check you.
And here's another thing. I found this out fishing last fall. I never knew it. If you have a child fishing with you, and we have four fish per person, one fish per person, whatever, the child fishing with you counts the same. So you can have two on one license or three on one license. It's going to be the smaller ones. They don't have to have license to fish, but the regs, they can keep a drunk. Okay, so if you were to two-drop instead of one.
The only thing you can
65
use.
65 and over, you can get a lifetime for.
65 and older, you can get a lifetime combination license, salt water and fresh water. I think it's $35, and which is the deal of the century. And you can actually get a hunting license with it if you want to as well.
I'm sure you want it.
It is the best deal in America.
New one, probably.
Some things that are some things that are some things that are happening.
Ask for refund.
Yes.
Some things that are happening here coming up that I wanted to let you know about. Larry Crosby is heading up the planning for our fishing tournament. You want to say anything to these folks before we cut them loose?
We had our first meeting. We're planning to put, we're putting the fishing tournament together. We're tentatively planning to get the second week, the second week of June, and we're going to be putting out, an email, about registration and so forth.
June 12th.
We're going to be putting out some information regarding, sign up. We'll be discussing how we're going to set it up as far as we're going to have teams, individuals. So we're going to have different categories, team category, individual category, the different types, species of fish and whatnot. And so we'll be giving you more information soon. We're just kind of ironing it out, and we're going to have, we'll have prizes and whatnot. So it should be a lot of fun. So if you don't have a boat and you want to participate, then we'll have the individuals who are willing to, bring someone on their boat.
So people with pontoons.
Yes, people with pontoons. Yeah, and if you have a kayak and you want to compete, you can compete in your kayak. So we're going to keep it easy and simple. A lot of fun. You can fish off the dock. You can fish off the dock. So we're going to make it easy and fun for everybody.
We're also going to revive something that was started here, which is a crab catching for kids contest.
Yes.
And Driss can tell you just a touch about that.
For the new residents that have not been here more than 2 years, because the last one we had it 2 years ago, it was a crabbing contest open to residents and guests, basically a lot of young kids, grandkids come here and participate. The bottom line, we go crab, just line, chicken and egg and line. No crab pots, none. And
are you looking at me?
No. What we end up adding his crab pot to stuff for us, we steam them at the end of the party. But the contest only for the line and the chicken, which really everybody enjoyed it. It was run by Bill Havanke, one of our residents. And he volunteered. He said yes, belongs in our social fleet or yacht club, which is the right place to be, and we'll get all the help for him. Definitely he's going to run it through the yacht club at this point. So that's exciting.
The best part.
And we cooked steamed them at the end. My buddy here catch more crabs for us in the crab pots.
Now, the other thing that's on the docket is an ocean fishing trip sometime this year.
Yes.
For Cypress Landing residents and guests, and Driss is also kind of doing the research piece on that. So, since you have the floor,
we did again 2 years ago. We had a headboat fishing with fishing on a headboat from Moorheads on the Carolina Princess. Dave Willock and Bill Proctor organized that to set it up. And that was really, really good. Everybody enjoyed it. We had, I believe, 34 or 35 people that went in. Husband and wives are very welcome. And we had the whole, almost half of the boat, I should say, Cypress Landing, residents there. It was enjoyable. I mean, really, we should do that more than once, as far as I'm concerned. Let's start the first one. Well, we're a little bit far away. We're almost 2 hours, a full day. Some of us went and spent the night there before 6 o'clock fishing trip.
Right.
That's some just drop them here.
Bottom fishing, right?
It's yes, yeah. All yeah, bottom yeah. fishing.
They have a great big huge sinker yeah. drops to the
it's,
bottom and they bite.
It's
and
the Carolina fish. Princess. If you guys want to look it up, we'll probably do the same thing. We before the COVID, Bill Proctor was thinking renting the whole boat, and the COVID hit and that went down the drain. A lot of people were looking forward to
out,
that.
We may want to.
And what depends on the interests. I mean, literally, it's set up by individual. Literally, we just set up a date. Everybody will call in reserve the date. Last time we had it, it was $100 with a T-shirt and a breakfast. So really, really great deal. I believe this year is $110, you know, for the whole day of fun.
So watch your email, and if you haven't been included in the fishing group up to this point, I'm going to give you a phone number and I'm going to give you an email address. And if you want to be included in emails and invitations to the meetings we're having in this group, send me an email. My email is B as in boy, D as in dog, 2012, Douglas, like my last name, D-O-U-G-L-A-S, @gmail.com. And my cell number is, if you want to text me, is 530-949-1332. Send me a text, tell me you want to be included in the mailing, make sure you ship me an email address so I can add you to our roster, and you'll be included in all information about the fishing group from this point forward.
Okay? What was your first name?
Bob. My first name is Bob.
Thank you.
All right. So the only last thing we would ask you to do is if you want to be part of the fishing group, we are a subsidiary of the Yacht Club, and they are sponsoring us. Please consider, if you're not a member of the Yacht Club, joining. Applications are here in the marina. You can get them from Tom or any one of us on the bridge. Skip Vail, by the way, is the Vice Commodore, Tom's a Commodore, you know most of us now. You can get Yacht Club applications, and we'd love to have you involved
as
we reopen and get started doing things. I want to thank the guys in the panel for doing a support.
Thank you.
Kelly Burke and Bill Davis for all the technical work. All of you that made this possible tonight. So thank you very much. And I've been told that a lot of people are leaving here and going upstairs. And if that's the case, enjoy yourselves. If that's not the case, enjoy yourselves also. Thank you.